Alrighty. Well, good morning and welcome to Rivervale Community Church. If you were here last week, you knew that our air conditioning wasn't working, and thankfully it was, which makes for a much longer service, I think, and I think that the air conditioning definitely is working. So thank you to everyone who's involved making sure that that got fixed. It's nice and cool in here. I'm so glad to see everybody here. I know it's hot outside, and a lot of people would rather stay in bed and whatnot. I'm just glad to see everybody here. If you are joining us, if you are a guest, welcome. Welcome. We're glad to have you here. At this point, I will just open up our call to worship with a verse from Psalm 100, 1 through 2.
Okay.
It's just, make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth, and serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. And Jim Campoli noticed that that verse said joyful noise, right? So you may think your music, what you're singing, is just noise, but God doesn't see it like that. I think he sees your heart. So with that, let us all rise to make a joyful noise together.
Teach me
have done. Omniscient, all knowing, he counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. What patience would wait as we constantly roam? What Father so tender is calling us home? He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Of kindness he lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood neath a debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more.
Children, you're staying up in service today.
At this time, let us pray. Lord God, at this time, we thank you for all that you provide to us each and every day, from our homes to our food to the very air we breathe. We ask that you bless what we return here today to you and use it to bless your kingdom here on earth. In Jesus' name, amen. So at this time, if you're visiting or new, we ask that you don't give. You don't have to give if you don't feel led to. If you do, that's great. We'd rather just have a card just letting us know that you're here and how to contact you and to be in contact with you. So there's that. Can people still hear me without this? I feel like my voice booms enough that I don't. Okay, I will try to avoid that. Apologize for that. Announcements for this week. Looking forward, July, August, we have nothing coming up. The first thing is that the Sunday evening Bible study, it will be on hiatus and will be resuming Sunday, 9 July. That's a Sunday evening Bible study. I believe previously they were studying the Ten Commandments. They've gotten up to Commandment 5, so we're taking a break, and I think when they get back, they'll be continuing Commandments 6 through 10. Okay, so and that will be resuming on Sunday, 9 July at 5 p.m. Looking forward in July, August, on Saturday, July 15th, there'll be a youth group bonfire. So youth group bonfire on Saturday, July 15th. So that should be a lot of fun. I think it'll just be a good time for the children to hang out and to just spend some time together and just enjoy. Who doesn't love fire and s'mores and things like that, and just enjoy creation and time together. On the 16th, on Sunday, after service, we'll have a special congregational meeting to talk about the parking lot and some other topics as well, but primarily the parking lot and some membership. So please join us if you are a member. We ask that you would stick around for after service so we can have a quorum and vote on these pretty important, and these are important topics. And on 31st July through 3rd August, Monday through Thursday, we will be having Vacation Bible School here. So far, we've got, I think, about 5 or 6 kids registered already, so they're starting to come in. So if you haven't registered and you're interested in registering, please do register. It's online. It's on our website. There should be a link there for the registration. So with that, I believe that concludes our announcements. And today's scripture reading, I am doing a little bit of everything today. I know normally we have people, but today you get all of me. So that's good or bad. I'm not sure what about. Thank you. Not sure if that's good or bad. Today's scripture reading comes from the book of Luke, chapter 9, verses 1 through 6. Okay, so it should be up there. It's again, Luke, chapter 9, verses 1 through 6. This is an easier one to read. I forgot. I originally also asked Jen to read it, but now I just started doing that. I apologize. The scripture reading today, and he called the 12 together and gave them power and authority over all demons and to cure diseases. And he sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal. And he said to them, take nothing for your journey, no staff, nor bag, nor bread, nor money, and do not have 2 tunics. And whatever house you enter, stay there, and from there depart. And wherever they do not receive you, when you leave that town, shake off the dust from your feet as a testimony against them. And they departed and went through the villages preaching the gospel and healing everywhere. God's word for us. Let us pray. Almighty Father God, you are great and you love us so much. We thank you for your love for us, even when we don't act, speak, or think like we should. Forgive us when we are not who we should be, and help us to want to change the people, to be the people you want us to be. Open our hearts and our minds to your word, as described here in Luke, and help us to trust and obey when you lead us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I'd like to thank everyone for joining us here today, and I'd like to again, the last time I preached here was a family service, and it's again, I have the pleasure of being here for another family service, so that's awesome. I'd like to have the kids up here, because it forces me to bring things, to really examine what we're studying. Because sometimes we assume that people know things, but our kids know the truth. They either know it or they don't. So it's great to go to that, back to the basics. As always, my hope as always is that we can all learn something from God's word together as a family. And today's reading from the Bible seems pretty short and straightforward. There are no really long names or places or complex things to pronounce. But the more we read and think about these 6 verses, the more we see that there's a lot of things going on here. actually. So in these six verses, even though a lot of people read through it very quickly, there's a lot going on there, and there's things that a lot of things that we can learn from. Which is why at the end, there will be a test for the kids. Okay, so hopefully as you came in here, the kids received a clipboard with the kids' sermon notes. Unlike school, which it may be a distant memory for some of you who are already on vacation and relaxing in school, what's school, you know? There will be prizes for you. This test has prizes, so that's a little better than school. It's a little bit different, so pay attention. It's multiple choice, so you just have to listen and circle the right answer to the questions. The answers will be, for the test, will be shared during the sermon, so pay attention. And as always, if you've been here before and seen me do this, I will stop my foot if it is something that you should be listening to, something that's important. I learned this technique actually from people in the military, in our armed forces. Sometimes when they teach classes to young soldiers, the instructor will stomp their foot and say, this may be on the exam, stomp, stomp, pay attention. So this may be on the exam, stomp, stomp, pay attention, okay? So I think this might be good for kids as well. If you give me your completed test after the service, if you get the questions right, you'll get a prize. I have a bag full. For kids 10 and over, if I ask you a question, I will ask you an additional question after you hand in your sheet to get the prize. You need to really, really pay attention. So if you're 10 or over, pay attention. Really listen. For kids who can't read well, you can get help from your parents or older siblings. And finally, kids, make sure your parents are paying attention, because sometimes parents have a tendency to fall asleep or doze off, you know? And you can even share the questions with them, so they can be thinking about the service too. But there is no test or prizes here for the adults, so except for those that come from hearing and applying the Word of God. I'm not Oprah, I can't just give out cars or sweaters or whatnot. The benefit is in the Word itself. So let's get into the Word together. At this point in the Bible, in Luke chapter 9, we see that Jesus' disciples, they've been with him for about a year. And it's been an amazing year. So we're not sure how long, but we think it might have been a year. So, but before we talk about what they've gone through and what they've seen up to this point, let's talk about what is a disciple, okay? A disciple, does anyone know what a disciple is off the top of their head? Anybody? You can yell out, it's okay, you don't have to raise your hand. Oh, okay. What is a disciple? Yes. A disciple is a type of student. Specifically, a disciple is a student, usually a student of a religious or a philosophical teacher who tries to learn as much as they can from them. They are a disciple. They follow them around. They want to follow the discipline that this teacher or this rabbi has. So a disciple is a student. A disciple is a type of student. Okay? So during this year or so with Jesus, his disciples, his students have spent days and nights living with Jesus, okay? These are students who have lived with Jesus. They spent day and night living with Jesus, preaching and who we know now, Jesus is God. They didn't know that yet. They were starting to figure out that there was something different about this teacher, but I don't think at this point that they knew he was fully God yet. They don't know that yet. And what was he doing? He was preaching the kingdom of God. They were listening to his sermons and his parables, seeing all of his miracles, the healings, the casting out of demons, the raising of dead people, as Pastor Nick discussed last week, the calming of storms. And they had a front row seat to all of it. So they are his disciples. They've been living with him day and night, and they've been front row seat. They've been watching everything firsthand, listening firsthand. They've had private time with Jesus nonstop. And Jesus is investing his time and his energy into these students, his disciples, watching them grow. So in Luke 9:1, when Jesus calls them together for a special meeting, and it's not like just a regular meeting like parents might have at work. If your parents go to an office, they have lots of meetings, most of which are probably not that important. But this is a very special meeting. This is where he is going to give them power and authority over all demons and to cure diseases. Okay, power and authority. I underlined that over there. But why power and authority? Why is that important? So kids, I'm going to give you an example, okay, about power and authority, and what power and authority is. When I was a child, when I was a young man, a very young man, many moons ago, sometimes my little sister would come up to me and tell me to clean my room. And my response would be, which is the normal child response, is, I don't have to because you're not my mother, not the boss of me. You're not the boss of me. You're not my mother. You can't tell me. You're not the boss of me. You're not my mother. You can't tell me what to do, right? I don't know if kids still use the "you're not the boss of me." Okay, I guess some kids, some parents are nodding, yes. They sometimes use the, you're not the boss of me, boss of me. So my sister was a lot smaller. I was still a pretty big kid, but my sister was a lot smaller than me. She did not have the power to force me to do anything, and she didn't also have the authority, because she's my little sister. She doesn't have the authority to command me, so she was not in charge. Now, if she had said, you'd better do it because mom said so, okay, well, that's a little bit different. Now that then she has the authority, right? That's the authority, because mom has given her the authority to tell me to clean my room, okay? It would have been different. She was speaking for mom, right? So she had the authority to speak on mom's behalf, okay? Now, that being said, I still might not have done it because I was lazy and did not want to clean up my room, okay? And she was tiny and she couldn't force me to. But then if my sister had told me, you better do it because mom said so, and if you don't, I'll tell mom. All of a sudden, not only does she have authority, she has authority and power to get me in trouble, okay? Because mom had given her both the authority to speak for mom and also the power to enforce it. Not my sister's own power, but the power to tell mom and to make it happen. And that would have been very bad for me. She had been given authority, my sister had said, because mom said so, and I'm gonna tell mom, she has now power and authority. So think about that, authority and power. So Jesus was giving both authority and power over demons and sickness to the disciples, to these close students that he had. Jesus was giving them some of the power to do some of the same things, the power and the authority to do the same things that he himself was doing, right? So he gave them the authority and the power to do the same things that he was doing, but why? Verse 2 tells us, and he sent them out to proclaim the kingdom and to heal, which is what Jesus was doing. He was proclaiming and healing. So he was giving them the power and the authority to do the kinds of things that he was doing. He was giving this to his disciples. For those who may not know what proclaim means, sometimes we think we know what words mean, but sometimes it's good to look at the actual definition. What does proclaim mean? It's a big word. It actually means to announce something publicly, like an official messenger. Okay? So I think usually when kings of England die or queens die, they usually say something like, the queen is dead, long live the king. That's the official proclamation. Okay, we've moved off, the queen has died, and now we have a new king. Long live the king. That is an official proclamation. You may have heard of the Emancipation Proclamation. It's an official decree. It's an official decree. Okay, so for you to announce something publicly, you are an official messenger. You have the authority and the power. So he's saying, you guys, I'm giving you power and authority to do these things, and you guys are now going to proclaim these things because you're my official messenger. The disciples were going to be the official messengers of Jesus, proclaiming the kingdom of God, and they are also going to heal. They are proclaiming the kingdom of God, and they are also going to heal. It was always confusing. So this is kind of interesting. It's always confusing to me that Jesus would mention healing again after talking about casting out demons and curing diseases. Because if you cure a disease, aren't they healed? If you cast out a demon, aren't they healed? Right? It sounds like he's just repeating himself. But when I looked into it, the actual word in the original Koine Greek is, the word is heal, but it also has the implications of restoration. Okay? So Greek, sometimes words in Greek have many different facets. And this one, instead, it's not just heal, but it's restoration, or to make things right again. So in the image here, you have these guys putting this bridge together. They're just restoring it. They're putting it together. They're healing it, they're restoring it, they're making amends, they're putting it together. That is the idea behind the word heal in this context. It's, you're proclaiming the kingdom of God and you're healing. You're restoring things like the way they should be. So the disciples were given power and authority to proclaim the kingdom of God, to officially announce it, and to heal and restore people. Because people at that time needed restoration. People today still need restoration with God. We still, today, things have not changed. 2,000 years later, many of us are still very much disconnected with God, with our Creator. So their main purpose, the reason that they were given power and authority, was to proclaim the kingdom, which is that Jesus is here. God is here. God wants a relationship with you. And to heal. Church, this is very much still a part of our mission today. Using God's leading and the Holy Spirit to proclaim the kingdom of God, and thus help people's relationship with God. If you are a Christian, you are an ambassador of the kingdom of God, and to spread that good news, which is God wants a relationship with you and people around you. So this is a big moment for the disciples. Even though I've glossed over it a lot of times, it's a big moment in their lives. Because they're going from being disciples or students, and they're becoming apostles. Okay? Disciples and apostles are not the same. Does anybody remember what an apostle is? I've actually mentioned this at a sermon a few weeks back. Anybody? Apostle? Okay. So a good word for an apostle, a synonym, but not quite exact synonym, is messenger. Apostle is a messenger, or literally from the Greek means one who is sent. They are sent with a specific purpose, a certain specific message. They are now going from being students to being people who are sent forth by Jesus to spread the mission. So they have suddenly gone from just being watching Jesus, from being on the sidelines, from listening to him, saying, okay, now I'm giving you the power and the authority to do these things that I have done to spread the message that I have spread. You guys go forth and you do it. It marks a transition in their lives from being disciples to apostles. And on the next slide, you can see apostle versus disciple, right? Again, apostle means to send forth, whereas disciple means student. And you don't really hear the word apostle used in the Old Testament, but it's used a lot. It's used a lot in the New Testament. Again, we use often the terms of the disciples and the apostles, 12 apostles and 12 disciples, interchangeably. The truth of the matter is, they're both disciples and apostles. They were disciples that eventually became apostles. Okay? We are also disciples and apostles, you know? Let me talk a little bit about that. But today, here in 2023, we are called to be more than disciples, but also apostles, to share the message of Jesus. I mean, it's great to be a student, right? It's great to be a student who learns, a disciple. But what is the purpose of this learning? The purpose has to be so that we can share what we have learned to those around us, to be messengers, to be apostles. This is important for us today. If you are a self-professing Christian, you are a messenger, not just a disciple. Again, you are a messenger, not just a disciple. You're not just a student. You've also been sent on that mission as well. Now the question becomes, it's a big charge. So Jesus gave them the power and he gave them the authority and he told them to do these things, to proclaim the kingdom and to heal, to restore people, to restore. But how did Jesus want them to do this? Verse 3 tells us more. And he said to them, take nothing for your journey, no staff, nor bag, nor bread, nor money, and do not have two tunics. Jesus is very clear here. Take nothing. Take nothing. Now, for some of you kids who may not know what a tunic is, I barely know what a tunic is. It's like a t-shirt / pants. You would wear it over. It'd be like you'd wear it down, like a big robe, and then you tie it off. Okay? So there's a picture on one of the next slides of what a tunic is. Okay? But this is a lot to take in, right? Jesus is very clear. He says, don't take anything. I'm sending you out on this journey, but you're not even going to take an extra t-shirt / pants. You're not going to take any food. You're not going to take your money. I freak out if I leave the house without my cell phone or my wallet. I get nervous. Jesus is commanding people. And in the morning when I leave for work, if I don't have coffee, it's a bad trip. And my trip's only 45 minutes to an hour to work. He's saying to them, bring nothing. Okay? It's a lot. So the question is, why did he say bring nothing? Okay, so I kind of was curious about this, so I read through a bunch of commentaries, and there are about three primary reasons why people say Jesus might have said, bring nothing. Number one, he wanted his disciples to travel fast and light, to go far in a short amount of time. Kind of makes sense. If you don't have to pack, you don't have to take time. If you're not carrying stuff, you can move a lot faster than when you carry luggage. If you ever tried to travel through an airport with children and luggage, you know it's not going to go fast. It's going to take some time. So that's one reason. Another reason was that there was a rule at the time among rabbis in that day that you couldn't enter the temple area with a staff or shoes or a money bag because it would give the appearance that you were trying to do business in the temple. If you came without the staff, the bag, or the money bag, or the shoes, it showed that you were there to do the service of the Lord. You weren't there to do business. You were serious about preaching the gospel. You're serious about talking about what you were there, about holy work. Disciples were engaged in such holy work, which makes sense. So this kind of makes sense, you know, that having this stuff, they went to the temples, if they had the bag or the staff or the shoes, it may have hindered their mission, okay? Again, the Talmud actually tells us that no one is to go into the temple mount with staff, shoes, or girdle of money or dusty feet. The idea again was that when a man entered the temple, he must make it quite clear he had left everything to do with trade and worldly business, worldly affairs behind. Okay, so that's reason two. One is to travel fast and light. The other is so he could enter the temple to show and teach. Okay, number two sounds really good. That sounds almost exact. Number one sounds really good also. But both fail to address why not food or an extra shirt at least. Okay? The Talmud fails to address why Jesus said, hey, don't even bring food and don't even bring an extra tunic. Why not? Okay? The third explanation I think that includes number one and two makes the most sense, which is Jesus was telling them to depend on God. Jesus was saying, not only these things, but you will depend on God. God will provide for you. It's not that the other two explanations aren't true. I mean, packing takes time, right? And carrying things makes it harder for you to travel, harder for you to enter the temple to share. But by telling them nothing, Jesus was saying that by telling his disciples, bring nothing, he was also saying, God will provide everything. God will provide everything. In Isaiah 58, 10 through 11 says this, if you pour yourself out for the hungry and satisfy the desire of the afflicted, then shall your light rise in the darkness and your gloom be as the noonday. And the Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your desire in scorched places and make your bones strong. And you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water whose waters do not fail. If you're there for the right reason, this is one way of saying, where God guides, God provides. Where God guides, God provides. If God is leading you someplace to do something, to make a change, or to go someplace, or to reach out to someone, and you're not sure how it's going to happen, if you feel the Holy Spirit truly working in you, feeling that quiet voice nudging you towards something, God will provide for you. In my own life, I've seen this recently. Some of you may know that my wife and I, our family, adopted a little boy last summer in 2022. Sorry, COVID's got me all confused. We actually started the adoption process in the summer of 2019. And we had felt the prompting of the Holy Spirit. We had prayed about it. We had felt the prompting that we should go ahead. This is something we had talked about doing for years, that we should go ahead and do this. So we started the paperwork, and we got the paperwork in just by the neck of the. We literally got a call saying, if you want to adopt, you should do it now because the program is about to change. We took that as a clear sign saying, it's time to do this. And then, of course, COVID came. And it changed a lot of things. Suddenly, paperwork that we needed from the State Department offices were closing. Suddenly, court offices were closing. Vital paperwork we needed. Suddenly, people were getting very, very sick. People were afraid to travel. Plane tickets were going sky high, or there were no plane tickets to get. Okay, but at the same time, and then we had questions. Okay, if we're going to go to pick up our son in Korea sometime in the future, we don't know when that's going to happen because we don't know when COVID's going to end. Who's going to watch our house? Who's going to take care of everything here? Okay. Yeah, and people were getting sick, and we were afraid of getting sick ourselves because we know that if we had gotten COVID, it would have changed everything. They probably would have delayed our adoption. It would have changed, if our child got COVID, it would have changed his adoption. There are a lot of moving pieces here. We weren't sure how things were going to work out. So, summer from 2019, we finally, in the spring of 2022, we finally got a message saying it was happening. We were going to go to Korea, but the problem was these are still things that we worried about because COVID was still raging, people were still getting sick, and no planes were flying in and out. One of the restrictions was that you'd have to stay at a hotel for 14 days in one room for 14 days while they tested you if you arrived in Korea. I was going to go with my whole family, so can you imagine a family of five in one hotel room for 2 weeks? Yeah, it was just miserable. The prospect of it was overwhelming, and it was expensive too. It's expensive to do that. But where God guides, God provides. About a week before we were about to go, they canceled that requirement, the hotel requirement. They said, no, you just need to get tested. The plane tickets that we thought were so expensive, all of a sudden the Korean Airlines said, COVID's starting to go down, we're gonna start giving more tickets out now. So the prices started to go down. Things weren't easy, but we were provided for. And when we left here, I left our home here, we had people from this congregation say, I will help you. Let me know what I can do to help you out. Let me know how I can support you and watch over yourself. Don't worry about that stuff. Focus on getting your son home. Again, God provided through people, through friends. Where God guides, God provides. So, if you feel that God is leading you somewhere, if you follow, he will provide. It may not be in the way you expected or wanted, or it might be even better than you thought, but where God guides, he will provide. So finally, Jesus tells them not to bring anything and gives his disciple the following command, the final command, the last stipulation. Whatever house you enter, stay there, and from there depart. And wherever they do not receive you, when you leave that town, shake off the dust from your feet as testimony against them. So what Jesus was saying was, when you went to a different town, not again, with nothing, and someone received you, stay there. You're not on vacation. You're not saying, oh, well, I might go to the Patterson house because I think they're serving meatballs. I'd rather stay there. Thank you very much. Or because they have good AC, rather than stay with, you know, somebody else. Wherever they received you, you were supposed to stay there. But also, at houses where you weren't welcome, at places where you weren't welcome, it's time to leave. So stay. You're not going house shopping. You're not on vacation. Not looking for better digs or food. And also, where you're not welcome, they were to shake off the dust of their feet and leave. Don't waste your time. Don't force yourself upon them. Just leave and have nothing to do with them at that time. Okay, and that sounds harsh. So for people who don't know what that means, shaking the feet, you know, I'll shake the dust off this two-bit town. Maybe you've heard something like that from a cowboy movie or a country western song or something like that. Literally, when you shake the dust off your feet, that was symbolic that if a Jewish person had to go through a Gentile city at the time, they would literally shake the dust off their feet saying, hey, I don't want to take anything from these Gentiles. I don't want anything to do with these people. They're different from me. Their ways are not my ways. I don't want anything to do with them. Similarly, the disciples were to shake the dust off their feet at places where they had been rejected. Essentially, just move on. Shake the very dust off your feet. You see, their jobs as preachers wasn't just to change minds, but to present the message, to proclaim the kingdom. You know, but if the kingdom wasn't received, they weren't supposed to stay there nonstop and keep on trying. There were other people who needed to hear the word. The simple truth of the matter is sometimes people are not ready to receive the gospel. They may have things going on in their lives. They may have things in their heart that are stopping them from hearing things clearly. That doesn't mean they'll always be like that. It just means at that time. And sometimes you just need to move on. Maybe move to another town, move to another person, or revisit the conversation later. Sometimes beating down somebody on the same thing over and over again doesn't work. And maybe a change in circumstances or a change in heart will change with how they listen. We're not asked. Sometimes the Spirit may say, move on. You're finished here. You know, and that may happen to someone in our family, someone we care about, or someone that we've prayed for a while. They may still have hard hearts. But again, it doesn't mean you give up, but sometimes you just need to walk back, move on, and maybe go to someone who will listen with the hopes that the person who isn't listening will open up their hearts one day. We're asked to be obedient, to do our best, but sometimes it's not up to us. Sometimes people just aren't ready to hear. We're not meant to be hurt. If we do share the gospel, if we do proclaim the gospel to someone, especially if they're a friend, it's not up to us to be hurt or judgmental or walk off in a huff. Our desire is to find the fertile soil of their hearts for the gospel and use the finite resources of time and energy for the greatest good, to share that to those who will listen. There's a difference between saying, I quit, I give up, and saying, well, I'll come back later. Again, one is with a huff, and it goes in the wrong spirit, and the other says, allowing God to do what God's going to do, to change their spirit, if at all possible. Samuel Wells, an English priest and professor at King's College in London, writes about sharing the message with those who are not ready to hear it. Don't carry that dust everywhere you go. Embittering relationships, souring friendships, sapping energy, leaking hope. Shake the dust off your feet. Don't take out your anger on people when you have no idea what's making them so bafflingly indifferent. Shake the dust off your feet. Don't judge them. That's God's job, not yours. And only God knows why they're so distracted or so passive or so frustrating or so silent. Shake the dust off your feet. And don't go on a self-righteous rant that assumes that you're the perfect embodiment of the gospel, and anyone who doesn't repent and be baptized this very instant must be stupid. Shake the dust off your feet. Shake, shake, shake. Again, people whose hearts are not ready to hear the gospel are not necessarily going to be that way forever. Circumstances change, and so do hearts. It's our job not to share. It's our job to share the message, but when they're not ready, not to judge them or ourselves, because sometimes we judge ourselves or take it personally. In verse 6, we see that the disciples ended up going out and that they did obey Jesus and they did do everything that he had told them to do. They set out and went on from village to village, proclaiming the good news and healing people everywhere, which is something of itself, in itself, is a powerful testimony. They heard and obeyed, and they trusted. How many of us can say that we always do the same thing? I know that I do not always. But that the fact that they can say, yeah, they did it. They were told, and then they did it, and they did it well. It's a powerful testimony that we should learn something from, and we can learn something from today. At this time, let us pray. Father God, as we read and ponder Jesus' words and his life with his disciples turned apostles, let us also be moved in our hearts to trust where you would guide us and to obey your commandments, knowing that you love us and want restoration in our lives and our relationships with you, and want us as your messengers to send that same love and healing to those who are ready to hear it. Let us be good messengers and ambassadors of your kingdom. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. At this time, we're going to sing our last song together. So if you could please stand if you're able.
Thank you. Today's benediction comes from 2 Peter 3:18. May you grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and to the day of eternity. Amen.